Hello learners, a very good day to all. I am Dr. Vishal Sood, teacher educator. In the previous lessons, we have discussed about the processes of measurement, assessment and evaluation. And we have also discussed about how these processes are different from each other and how these processes are supplementary and complementary to each other. In today's lesson, we are going to discuss about expected learning outcomes, that is ELOs, classroom processes and assessment. So our today's discussion will focus on learning and assessment. A brief overview of what we have discussed in the previous lessons that we will discuss. Then we will discuss about the meaning of expected learning outcomes, ELOs, then how expected learning outcomes, or which are also known as learning objectives, how these ELOs or learning objectives are framed, that will be discussed by us. And then what is the importance, what is the significance of expected learning outcomes in classroom processes or in teaching learning process, that will be discussed. And then in the last part of today's discussion, we will discuss about relation between expected learning outcomes, classroom transaction and assessment. So our today's discussion will focus on these five major points related to learning and assessment, expected learning outcomes, how to frame those objectives, how, what is the importance of expected learning outcomes, and what is the relation between expected learning outcomes, classroom transaction and assessment. So first, learning and assessment, what we have discussed in the previous lessons, what we have learned in the previous lessons. As you know, learning is a purposeful activity through which change in behavior is brought about. That means learning is a relatively permanent change in behavior. Through the process of learning, we try to modify the behavior of the learner. That means learning is always a purposeful activity, or learning is carried out with a certain purpose, and that learning means to bring a change in behavior of the student. Any subject included in the school curriculum has specified learning objective. That means any subject which is taught in the school, just like science, mathematics, languages, social sciences, arts and drawing, then physical education, all these subjects which are included in the school curriculum has specified learning objectives. That means certain objectives have been set for these subjects, that why these particular subjects are being taught to the students in the school, or why these subjects have been included in the school curriculum. Then it is expected that after studying this particular subject, students shall demonstrate the competencies or the behavior specified. That means any subject which is taught in the school, after teaching that particular subject, it is expected from a student that the student will imbibe the particular understanding or the learning about that content matter, or the particular competencies or the behaviors which are specified in that particular subject or in that particular content matter. That means a student has to demonstrate certain competencies or the behaviors or the learning based on a particular subject matter. In order to find out the change in behavior, what we do, whether the student has acquired the competencies after studying a subject, how will you assess that? You evaluate the student, you take the test from the student. Either you ask oral questions or you give written questions, or you observe the behavior of the students in the class or outside class. That means whether the learning has been taken place or not, whether the student has learned the concepts or not, in order to find out that change in behavior, in order to assess that learning, the process of assessment becomes an integral part of teaching learning process or integral part of the instruction. That means learning and assessment, they are related to each other. Learning is change in behavior, and how to assess that change in behavior, we carry out the process of assessment or evaluation. So, about this learning, how learning takes place, what teaching methods are adopted, what teaching learning materials are used, and how to assess or how to evaluate the student or how to know the effectiveness or efficacy of teaching learning process, for that we carry out the process of assessment or evaluation. So, about all these we have already learned in the previous lessons. Now, what were the functions of assessment? The functions of assessment, as you can see on the screen, the functions of assessment is to know or is to place the students in the next class or in the next grade. That means assessment is carried out to grade the students, to certify the students and promote them to the next class. Then another function of assessment is the advancement. Advancement, that is to enhance learning among the students. That is also, that is assessment for learning. And assessment of learning means we try to assess the students' competencies, and on the basis of that we grade the students and place them in the next or promote them to the next class. So, the grading, placement and advancement of learning, these are the functions of assessment. Another function of assessment is to know the appropriateness or the effectiveness of curriculum transaction. Curriculum transaction, whether it has been effectively transacted, whether the content matter has reached to the students in an effective and appropriate manner. In order to know that, we make the process of assessment. Then, whether the instructional material used by the teachers during the teaching learning process, whether the teaching aids used by the teachers during the teaching learning process, whether that instructional material or teaching learning material has been effective in terms of enhancing learning among the students, has been proved to be successful in terms of understanding among the students. Regarding this, the decisions are taken on the basis of assessment results. So, the assessment functions are grading, placement, advancement of learning or enhancement of learning, to know the effectiveness of curriculum transaction, and to make decisions regarding the instructional material to be used during the teaching learning process. So, these are the functions of assessment. Now, what we mean by expected learning outcomes? This is the new part that you are going to learn in this lesson. Expected learning outcomes or ELOs. As you can yourself examine your teaching learning process, which you carry out in your school, which you carry out in your class, what you do at the initial stage, you can see on the screen. First, you have a particular subject on which you make students learn. That is, you may be a teacher of social science, you may be a teacher of mathematics, you may be a teacher of environmental sciences or EVS. Then, after selection of that particular subject, a subject has certain content areas. Those content areas have been divided into certain units. Certain units are then further divided or classified into chapters. So, this is the content matter, this is the subject matter which you teach in the class. First is subject, subject has content areas has units, and units have chapters. Now, after making decisions about the chapters, then you specify the content matter or the topics. That means the chapters are made up of different topics or specific content matter. A chapter has many topics included in it, or a chapter has a different content matter included in it. Then these topics can have different facts and concepts. As you can see on the screen, below the specific content matter or below the topics, there is facts and concepts. That means topics are made up of, or topics are comprised of, facts and concepts. Then these facts and concepts make a platform for framing expected learning outcomes or learning objectives. That means expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives, they are based on the content matter, They are based on the subject, they are based on the specific topics, they are based on the specific facts or concepts. That means learning objective. What we try to make the students understand about particular learning concepts. For that, we must have certain objective. We have to frame objectives for learning of those facts and concepts. So these learning objectives or expected learning outcomes are framed on the basis of the content matter or the specific topics or the facts. Now, what are expected learning outcomes? What we mean by ELOs or learning objectives? These are called learning objectives. What we mean by learning objective? It is an intent communicated by a statement. An intent. What you want to teach, your intention, what you want to make the students learn or understand about, that your intention is communicated through a statement. That intention is known as a learning objective. For example, you are teaching the topic of area of a rectangle in mathematics to the students of class 6th. Then you wish, or your intention is, that at the end of your lesson, at the completion of your teaching, the students must be able to find out the area of a rectangle if the length of that rectangle or breadth of that particular rectangle has been given to them. Then that is your intention, that at the end of the lesson, at the completion of the lesson, the students will be able to find out or calculate the area of rectangle if length is 5 cm and the breadth of that rectangle is 3 cm. So that means this find out the area of the rectangle, it is an intention and it is the expected learning outcome. You are expecting this thing, that this will be the learning outcome among the student. So whenever you go to your class, you must have certain objective, you must have certain intentions in your mind. And those intentions are the learning objective. You wish that these intentions or these expectations must be fulfilled, or this learning must take place among the students. So these expectations are known as expected learning outcomes, which are also called learning objectives. Now, these expected learning outcomes must have one characteristic, that these expected learning outcomes should have high power of communication. That means these learning outcomes or these learning objectives should be written in behavioral terms. Now, what we mean by behavioral terms, objectives in behavioral terms, or the objectives with high power of communication? That means what the expectations of teachers are, the same meaning should be carried out to the reader or to the viewer or to the student. That means what I wish as a teacher, that students at the end of my class will be able to do this, will be able to understand this. The same thing must be understood by the student. So that means high power of communication. That means what my intention is, the same meaning should be carried out to the audience, should be carried out to my students. So that means behavioral terms, practical terms. Now, I'm wishing as a teacher that my students at the end of the class should be able to define a particular term, define a noun. For example, in English, at the end of my class, the students will be able to define noun. And if my student in the class will be able to give the definition of noun, either in written form or in oral form, then I'll say that this objective, that is define noun, was having high power of communication or was written in behavioral terms. Sometimes it is stated that the students will be able to explain noun. Now, when we say explain noun, the explain word, it is appropriate for the higher classes, where the students or where the individuals have that level of maturity, that level of understanding, and that they are able to explain that in an elaborative manner. But in the lower classes, where you teach to the elementary school students, from the students from first class to eighth class, that those objectives should be very precise, should be very specific in nature. They should be having high power of communication, because explain word cannot be understood by the students at the lower level. So for those students, explain noun will not be an appropriate objective or expected learning outcome. There, the expected learning outcome in an appropriate or proper manner will be define noun, because that will carry the same meaning to all, and all the students in your class will know that after the class I have to give the definition of this particular word noun. So expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives should have high power of communication, and they should be written in behavioral terms. Objectives or expected learning outcomes should be framed by following SMART technique. Now, as a teacher, you must know how to frame objectives. What is this SMART technique to write objectives in behavioral terms or write expected learning outcomes which are having high power of communication? Now, what is this SMART technique? How to frame expected learning outcomes by SMART technique? You can see on the screen what SMART indicate. SMART S. S means specific. That means objective should be very specific to the content matter. It should be directly related to the content matter. It should be directly related to the fact or the concept which you are teaching in the class. Second thing, M. SMART. M. M is measurable. Your objective should be measurable. Objective should be, or expected learning outcomes should be framed in such a manner that at the end of the class, you must have certain technique, you must have certain tool to measure whether that objective, whether that expected learning outcome has been achieved or not. So, this thing must be kept in mind that any objective, any expected learning outcome should be framed in such a manner that at the end of the class, it should be measurable. Then A. A means achievable. Objectives or the expected learning outcomes should be framed in such a manner that they should be achievable. They should be practicable to achieve. This is the third characteristic while framing of objectives or expected learning outcomes with the help of this SMART technique. R. R means realistic. Realistic means objectives or the expected learning outcome should be real in nature. That means they should be directly related to the student life, and they should be visible whether those objectives have been achieved or not. It should be visible in terms of the overt behavior of the student, outer behavior of the student. That means the learning among the students has taken place or not. It should be visible in the outer behavior. That should be expressible in the outer behavior. That is realistic. And T, time bound. Any objective, any expected learning outcomes must be framed in such a manner that it can be achieved in a particular period of time. That means if an objective is framed in such a manner that it cannot be achieved within a period of 35 minutes and you are going to teach that particular concept, then you must have broken that concept or broken that content matter into smaller parts. That means objective should be framed in such a manner that in a particular period of time, in a period of 35 minutes, in a period of 40 minutes, or in a within a period of 1 week, it should be achieved. So that means SMART, S for specific, M for measurable, A for achievable, R for realistic, and T for time bound. So expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives or specific objectives, or also known as instructional objective, they should be framed, they should be formulated by applying these technique, or by taking into consideration that every objective should be specific. No two objectives, no two facts can be combined in a single objective. It should be avoided as a teacher, except where you want to differentiate between the two things. Differentiate between assessment and evaluation. Here, two concepts are included in one objective. Suppose I am teaching you in a class, this class, and I expect that my students will be able to differentiate between assessment and evaluation. So this statement, differentiate between assessment and evaluation, it is an expected learning outcome. It is a learning objective. Now, this learning objective has two concepts. One is assessment, the other is evaluation. Here, these two concepts can be combined because we are comparing or we are differentiating between assessment and evaluation. But if we want to define that, I expect that at the end of the lesson, the students will be able, or the learners, you sitting at far places, will be able to define assessment at the end of this lesson. Then my objective, my expected learning outcome is define assessment. I should not write like this, define assessment and evaluation. We should specify these and have single concept in this. Define assessment will be a different objective, and define evaluation will be a different objective or expected learning outcome. That means every objective should be specific in nature. Every objective should be measurable. It should be framed in such a way that it can be measured with certain tools or devices. It should be realistic in nature. It should be achievable in a particular period of time. That time period may be one single class of 35 minutes. That time period may be two classes, but that must be specified. As a teacher, you must be clear that how much time should be devoted to this particular objective or to this particular concept for making the students learn about this part. So this is the technique for framing expected learning outcomes or learning objectives by following SMART technique. Now, some examples, as you can see on the screen, of expected learning outcomes. What are the examples? On completion of the topic, the students will be able to. That means, as a teacher, what you expect? When you will complete the topic, your students will be able to identify important places like Delhi, Kolkata in the map of India. Suppose you are teaching social sciences and particularly the places of India. Now, you wish that on a map of India, your students will be able to identify important places. When you will complete your teaching, when the teaching learning process of one period or two periods will be completed, your students must be able in identifying or locating the important places like Delhi, Mumbai, Calcutta in the map of India. So if the students, and what you do at the end of the class or at the end of two classes, you give a map to the student and ask them that now locate where Calcutta is located. And if the students successfully do that, then you will say that you have succeeded in your teaching, or the learning has taken place among the students. Now, this part, as you can see on the screen, identify important places like Delhi and Kolkata in the map of India. This is expected learning outcome. This is a learning objective. You are expecting that the students will be able to identify and locate these places in the map of India. Before starting your teaching, you are expecting that this type of learning will take place among the students. Similarly, reduce simple fractions to the lowest terms. Suppose you are teaching mathematics and you are teaching simple fractions part to the students of class 5th or class 6th. And you are expecting before teaching, before entering the classroom, while planning your lesson, you are expecting from the students that they will be able to reduce simple fractions to the lowest terms, then that is an expected learning outcome. That is a learning objective which you are framing before going to the class. And at the end of the class, if your students are able to reduce simple fractions given by you to the lowest terms, then you will say that the learning has taken place among the students. So, this is expected learning outcomes, and finally, after the class, the result is there. You can compare whether the learning outcome has been achieved by the student or not, whether your expectations have been met or not. So, these are, but these objectives, these expected learning outcomes should be framed in a very accurate manner by following SMART technique. Then another example you can see on the screen. Draw a diagram of flower showing its different parts. Suppose you are teaching EVS and you are expecting your students that they will be able to draw a diagram of flower showing its different parts. Now, this is your expectation. This is an expected learning outcome which you are expecting before going to the class or classroom or at the time of planning your lesson. And suppose you teach everything in an appropriate manner by adopting appropriate teaching method, by employing teaching learning material, and at the end of the class you assign a work to the student that draw a diagram now of a flower showing its different parts, label it well and color it well, and if your students are able to do that, then your expectation has been met out. That means expected learning outcome or the objective that has been set by you before going to the classroom has been successfully achieved by the students. Now, in this example, in all of these three examples, the term identify, reduce or draw, the meaning is very clear to the student what they have to do, what the teacher is expecting from them. The teacher is expecting that they will be able to identify the places in the map of India. The teacher is expecting that the students, they are able to reduce simple fractions to the lowest terms. Or the teacher is expecting, draw a diagram of the flower showing its different parts. So, the meaning will be very clear. This is high power of communication or the objectives in behavioral term. What the teacher is expecting, the same meaning is being carried out to the student that what the expectation is from them by the teacher. So, these are some examples of expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives. As a teacher, you must frame these expected learning outcomes, learning objectives when you go to your class. You must be very clear why you are going to the class. What are your learning objectives? And at the end of the lesson, you assess, you evaluate either through oral questions, either through written questions, whether those expectations or those parameters have been met out or not. So, as a teacher, you must frame learning objective, and these give you guideline how to teach. These ELOs provide you directions, how to teach in a particular manner, what teaching learning methods are to be adopted, what type of instructional material are to be used during teaching learning process. All these decisions can be taken safely if we have framed expected learning outcomes, if we have framed learning objectives in an appropriate manner, as we have already discussed, by following SMART technique, by keeping into consideration that expected learning outcomes should be specific, measurable, achievable, realistic and time bound. Now, what is the importance of ELOs? The expected learning outcomes are very helpful in planning and designing teaching learning activities. You can see on the screen that expected learning outcomes are helpful in all the three processes: planning of teaching learning process, organization of teaching learning process and assessment of teaching learning process. That means the expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives, they help you in planning and designing teaching learning activities and selecting teaching learning material. That means how to teach in an effective manner, how to design different teaching learning activities, how to select or how to develop teaching learning material, or how to make use of that particular learning material. All these decisions at the stage of planning can be taken safely, can be taken appropriately if the expected learning outcomes have been framed by you as a teacher. If there is that the students will be, suppose you are teaching a concept on mathematics and you are saying that the students will be able to measure the area of the classroom, then it will help you in teaching that while the teaching learning process, you will make use of a meter scale and ask the students to measure the length of the classroom, to measure the breadth of the classroom, and finally they will be able to calculate or compute the area of the classroom. So, what teaching activity is to be performed in the class, what teaching learning material is to be used in the class, that all can be decided on the basis of the expected learning outcomes. They help in that. Then, expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives also help in organizing teaching learning process. They help in selecting and implementing teaching learning strategies. How to organize classroom transaction, how to interact with the students, at and when the students will be reinforced, when the questions will be asked, what type of questions will be asked, what type of activities and to whom the activity will be given. All these decisions can be taken if the learning objectives have been framed in an appropriate manner. The third importance of expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives is the assessment. These expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives also help in assessment activities. How to assess the students? Suppose you have an expected learning outcome, you framed an expected learning outcome or a learning objective that the students will be able to draw a diagram of a flower showing its different parts or labeling its different parts. This is your expected learning outcome. That means you are expecting that at the end of the lesson, the students will be able to draw a diagram of a flower showing its different parts. Now, how will you assess that? You have a clear-cut indication that at the end of the class, you will assign a work to the students and ask them to draw a diagram of the flower, label it, color it. You can't say that, you can't ask an oral question from the students that what are the different parts of flower, tell me. This will be an inappropriate question related to that particular learning outcome. Your learning outcome was draw a diagram of flower. Then the assessment will be also on the basis of this particular learning, expected learning outcome. That is, the students will be asked to draw a diagram and they will be asked to label that particular diagram. Then, now how this was decided? This was decided on the basis of the learning outcome, expected learning outcome or the learning objective that you have earlier set out while at the time of planning of teaching learning process. So, the expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives, they are very helpful in all the stages of teaching learning process, at the time of planning, at the time of organizing, and at the time of assessment of the teaching learning process. Now, what is the relation between expected learning outcomes, transaction, classroom transaction, and assessment? You can see on the screen, expected learning outcomes are the learning objective which you set at the time of planning for teaching learning process, which you set during the planning stage. After planning for your teaching learning process, you go to the class, you carry out teaching learning process in the classroom. That means teaching learning process is, or the classroom transaction process is carried out on the basis of the learning objectives. What learning objectives, what instructional objectives or what expected learning outcomes have been set by you at the time of planning stage, they are kept into consideration, they are taken into consideration, and accordingly the teaching learning process is followed. That means The teaching learning process is based on expected learning outcomes. Then, when the teaching learning process is complete, then at the end of the class, you evaluate the student. That means you carry out the process of assessment to know whether the objectives which have been set by you, which have been framed by you, have achieved to some extent or not, or to a greater extent. That means after carrying out teaching learning process or at the end of the teaching learning process, you try to evaluate to what extent the learning has taken place among the student, or in other words, to what extent those objectives have been achieved or not. For that, you ask oral question, you may ask written question, or you may give some practical work or any activity. So, through different measures, you can carry out the evaluation or assessment of the students at the end of the class. Now, suppose what happens? The students will not be able to understand a particular concept or a particular part of that teaching learning process or that content matter. That means the students have faced difficulty, or students were having a particular learning difficulty in that. That's why they were not able to understand. And how this comes into picture? This was due to the assessment or the evaluation which you have carried out. Now, what you will do? Will you move to the next lesson next day? No. As an effective teacher, your work is to make those students learn about those hard spots or those difficulties, to remove those learning difficulties. And for that, you provide remedial measures. That means on the next day, you have another expected learning outcome, or you have another learning objective in your mind, that whatever they have not learned in the previous class, those difficulties are to be removed. The remedial measures are to be provided for that. That means your learning objective will be based on the assessment or the evaluation which has been carried out by you. So that means learning objective or the expected learning outcomes are framed on the basis of the assessment or the evaluation procedures. Similarly, the expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives, they are giving a direction to the teaching learning process. And that teaching learning process, whether has succeeded in achieving its objectives or not, for that we carry out the process of assessment or evaluation. So that means there is a strong or a cyclic relationship between the expected learning outcomes, teaching learning process, and assessment. One is giving feedback to the other, and the other is giving feedback to the third one, and in this process, this cycle goes on, and the ultimate purpose of this cycle is to enhance learning among the students, to improve the teaching learning process. So, this is the relation between expected learning outcomes, classroom transaction, and assessment, which is having a cyclic relation, a close relation, and supplementary and complementary to each other. Now, some important points which you must remember as a teacher. The classroom process does not process in a simple and linear fashion. That means the expected learning outcomes, teaching learning process, and assessment, this is a cyclic process. If on the one day the students will be not able to understand certain particular concepts or facts, then the teacher has to modify his objectives, his teaching learning strategies, his instructional material, so that the learning can be enhanced. So, teaching is not, or the classroom process is not, a simple or a linear process proceeding in a single linear fashion. Then, assessment may lead to modification of expected learning outcomes. In that cyclic process, you see, you saw that the assessment results can help in modifying the expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives. Why the students have not able to understand about a particular concept? That objective can be changed on the basis of the assessment practice or assessment process followed by you. Assessment can be conducted at any time and not merely at the end of topic or unit. Assessment, it can be conducted during the class, at the end of the class, after 5 minutes, after teaching a particular concept, or after teaching two concepts. It is up to the teacher to decide at which time the assessment will remain appropriate or through which the assessment can be carried out to enhance learning among the students. So there is no fixed schedule to carry out assessment, and that particular assessment which is carried out by the teacher at any particular time, depending on the situation, depending on the content matter, that assessment is known as formative evaluation. Now, learners, what we have studied in this lesson, today's lesson, that is, what are the functions of assessment, what we mean by expected learning outcomes, how these expected learning outcomes or learning objectives can be framed, what is smart technique to frame expected learning outcomes or the learning objectives, why expected learning outcomes are important for teachers and students, and how expected learning outcomes, classroom transaction and assessment are related to each other, and there is cyclic relation between these three, that is expected learning outcomes, classroom transaction and assessment. So we discussed about all these aspects about expected learning outcomes, classroom transaction and assessment and their relation. I hope that you have all understood about all these aspects in a better way. Thank you very much. Have a good day.